Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the very first, the inaugural episode of VisPrivus. This is an iState.tv show. You're laughing and you shouldn't be laughing. It's a very serious show, very serious name. I don't need my co-host to be laughing at the name. My name is Paul Gordon. And I am here with, he just goes by Dimitri. It's just like him and Madonna related. Their last name is...
How'd you know? We are related.
Yeah, their last name is... That's it, right there. Did you hear it? Dimitri. So, let's start off maybe talking... Go ahead.
Important people don't need two names. You either know me or you don't. That's all.
I know his last name. And I can...
So, how many different kinds of shows are we doing now?
Just two.
Oh, two?
Just two. We're doing Full Auto, which is basically...
And New Shooting USA?
No, we're not doing New Shooting Self-Defense, no. We're doing Full Auto. Now that we're doing VisPrivus, we're actually going to do more gun stuff on Full Auto more consistently, because some of the stuff that maybe we talked about Full Auto that didn't quite fit, we're gonna do on VisPrivus. This is one of the reasons why we did this show, is because we love Full. I mean, I love talking
guns.
What
happened to State of Wake?
This is State of Wake Redux. This is State of Wake 2.0. This is VisPrivus is the rebranded name of State of Wake. That's essentially what this is.
Why did we change the name?
Why?
We just lost like three people who were listening.
We're building up an audience with Full Auto. We never really build up an audience with State of Wake. It's been a while since we did a State of Wake show. How long has it been? A few months?
It has been. It's been too long.
It's been too long. And it's like we do Full Auto and there's like so many things that we wanted to talk about that really didn't fit the Full Auto show when we had planned on doing State of Wake. And one of the reasons that I'm actually changing the name State of Wake is how many people now are using that? Are you woke? And not all of them are very nice people, let's just say.
I've never heard that before. But
oh, really?
I'll think
it, oh, no. It's a thing. It's a thing. Leftists are using it. White supremacists. White leftists are using it. White supremacists are using it. Flat earthers are using it. Are you woke? Are you woke? Well, you know, I'm woke. And everybody's, I'm woke. Are you woke? I'm woke. And I'm like, you know what? I don't know about this name anymore. State of Wake name.
So just when we were getting popularity with our tag.
We were never getting popular with State of Wake. Full Auto is building an audience.
You are self-defeating.
State of Wake, what's your State of Wake? It's
you're self-defeating.
You know, in
you're
another
sabotaging in a, my career in, as a
podcaster who doesn't get paid to be a podcaster, that career.
Dude, you promised me I'd get paid someday.
I did. I don't remember that.
Oh, yeah, you did.
I said
this would be like Howard Stern with girls, you know, running
no,
around.
No.
You said that.
We don't do those, the kind of shows that girls in bikinis would necessarily be attracted to. So
it's
probably, no, yeah, I definitely think. And this show is going to be a little bit more, I guess a little bit more, I don't want to say cerebral, but we're going to get a little bit more into detail in things
in this
show.
Oh, I think the terminology is egghead?
Yes. Yes, so eggheads of the world.
A little more egghead.
Yeah, this is... You know what this show is? The Full Auto... I mean, Full Auto has a real purpose, and we want to do something very serious with Full Auto. We want to build up a broad audience. Full Auto is something down the road that, you know, we think maybe we could someday make money off of. This show? This is our... All the thoughts that we have in our head that we never get to share on Full Auto. That's what this show is. But there's more to it than that. And it's kind of contained in the name. And you know what the
name
means.
What's the name again?
VisPrivus.
Are you allowed to say that around small children?
I say it around small children all the time, and parents clap and say thank you. So,
Vic's
yeah.
Penis?
No, VisPrivus. VisPrivus.
But it sounds like Vic's penis.
It does not. It sounds like VisPrivus. You're totally...
Is that Latin or Hungarian?
It's Latin. Viz means power, and Privus means individual.
The body part?
It means individual. It's where you get private from, but not privates. Private as in individual. A private affair. So VisPrivus kind of contains the philosophy of the show within the name, which is, and I use the word power for, well, as we do the show, you'll start to understand more when I say power, what I mean. Most people, when they think power, they just think force, guns, but there's a lot more to power than just force, than just guns. Power is your ability to make stuff yourself is a form of power, because it means that you don't have to depend on others to make power for you. So VisPrivus is, it's about what empowers an individual to be self-determined, self-sustaining, and
self-reliant.
Self-reliant, exactly.
I was guessing at that one.
Sure. No, but that's absolutely right. Now, in Full Auto, we concentrate much more on the self-defense aspect, and especially now that we're doing this show, we'll definitely focus a lot more Full Auto on the self-defense aspect, because Full Auto, we also dealt with a little bit with the self-reliance as well, but now we're going to do that more in this show. But the idea here is that if you have two people, two entities, whether it's two individuals, two groups, two governments, to whatever it is, two entities that can cognizantly interact with one another, if they don't have the same shared standards, voluntary shared standards, the only rate of exchange that really matters between them is power. And there will tend to be a temptation from one or the other to want to coercively get from the other what they couldn't get through honest, open persuasion. So with that in mind, you look around in your life and you ask yourself, what are all the ways in my life that I am on the wrong end of that power spectrum, where whatever entity I'm interacting with that I happen to not share the same standards with voluntarily, whether that entity has a degree of power that would, it cost it less than what it would get from coercing me. And if you look at your life, almost every single one of us, if we look at our lives, we're going to find areas in our life where that balance of power is not in our favor. Are you still with us, Mr. Dimitri? You look like you're falling asleep there.
Playing solitaire on my...
You're playing solitaire while we're doing the show. Are you kidding me?
Well, you're kind of like going on about stuff like...
That's, kind of
boring.
Kind of explaining the show here. So that's, yes,
well,
exactly.
Can we get into the nuts and bolts of this?
Okay, well, what are the nuts and bolts? Why don't you tell me?
Well, let's talk about a specific situation where applies.
Let's talk about property.
Oh, do you really want to go down that road?
Yeah, let's talk about property. Where is
what
the
about
balance
it?
Of power in property? And since we're largely an American audience, let's stick with America. Where is the balance of power regarding property in America today, Dimitri? Where do you fit in with your property that you own?
I don't own property. I rent
it from
the government.
What do you mean? You have paperwork that says you own it, right?
Yeah, that's an illusion. I rent my property from the government.
Why do you say that?
Well, because if I don't pay the taxes, or should I say rent, on this property, I get to lose it to the government. And then they'll take the property and sell it to someone else who was willing to play ball with them. That's not ownership. That's something very different.
You have this property which your name is on, you're liable for.
Oh, absolutely, you're liable for.
Somebody
if
does
someone
something
trips and falls,
right. You
it's
you
on me. It's not on the government, it's
no,
on me.
No, it's on the government. What prevents the government from just kicking you off and taking the property that de facto is actually theirs? What prevents them from doing that? Right now.
Very little.
Well, then why won't they? Why don't they?
Because it's better to control than own. They are reaping far more by controlling my property than they are from owning my property. I hold on to all the liabilities
and they ownership, and they and just they get are, the profit, even if there isn't a profit, they still get the profit, whether there is isn't.
They get theirs, whether you like it or not.
Oh, they get
whether
their pound of flesh, no matter what.
Absolutely,
but
so
it's in their best interest. It's not their benevolence that prevents them from showing up and telling Dimitri, Dimitri, you do realize that this is, I mean, this is ours, so we're going to go ahead and take it. The reason they don't is because it's in their best interest for Dimitri to accrue the liabilities, to be the one that has to pay for the upkeep, keep it maintained, to if you own a business, to make the business profitable and keep people spending money on your products and services, a fair portion of which is government tax revenue. You know,
You said tax.
I said tax. I did.
Yeah.
Dirty word.
I think people living in the United States as it was being founded would not have tolerated taxes. As a matter of fact, they didn't. There were multiple rebellions against taxation. And here we are,
and
40% of our wealth being transferred out of our pockets and into the pockets of an institution that really isn't looking out for our individual best interest. It's looking out for, first and foremost, itself.
That's the primary concern for the institution. And when we say institution, we mean a collection of individuals who directly or indirectly benefit from the mechanisms of what you call an institution. There are real people behind that name institution, and they derive real benefits from it. And I'm not here to knock the government or not knock the government. I am here to show you the reality of power in America today. You don't own a single thing. Well, you certainly don't. You don't own property. You don't own land. You don't own homes. You don't own businesses.
Look at how the income tax is structured, the one that was passed in 1913, and it was passed bipartisan, by the way. How is that worded?
There's no limitation. There's correct. None.
It's, they can come into your house and take everything and everything you own and every dime you have and all the food that you have to feed your family.
And there's two reasons why they won't. Two reasons. Now, I would argue right now they're maybe you're heading towards seeing maybe a second reason emerge. But right now, mostly the reason that they don't is because it's more profitable for them to let you accrue the liability and they collect the booty. But the second reason will be, even if they wanted to, if they believed that the cost of taking your land from you would be too high, and it wouldn't be too high for them to take land from one person, but if they believed by taking land from that one person that it could produce a level of upheaval that would upset their bottom line, which, you know, government is a business. That's pretty much what it is. I call it a coercive enterprise, and that's not a judgment of good or bad. It's just government is there to make money. That's its primary goal. The goal of the people within government is to make as much money as possible. So if they feel that your actions will trigger a series of other actions that could cost them, then they may let you slide. They may not intervene. But if they get to a point where for one reason or another they decide that it's more beneficial for them to take your land, and the cost isn't too high and the ramifications aren't too wide, they'll just take your land, dude. There's no law. There's no constitutional amendment that is going to prevent them from taking your land.
Look at all the grazing land that they're taking all over the country. And they're saying, well, it's to protect the turtles. It's to protect the spotted owls. It's to protect this rare butterfly. It's to protect this, that, and the other. And then you find out that, oh, yeah, and by the way, the federal government now has the water rights to this property. And did we mention there's an underground river? Oh, we didn't mention that before. Oh, too bad you didn't know. Dude, this is
sucks to be you. Right.
Yeah. This has been going on out west now for decades, if not a century or more, where ranchers keep losing their grazing rights. I mean, it's not news. It's been in the news for years now that there's a resistance to the government. And, you know, Nevada is what, like 80% owned by the federal government? How does that happen?
Yeah, how does the state let itself be owned, 80% of its land be owned by the federal government? Could you imagine if you tried to do something like that in 1800?
Oh, there would be a war.
There would be a war.
A war without question. And there have been multiple range wars where groups of people have come out against the federal agents that are sent there to confiscate these people's lands. And it doesn't usually end well for the federal government. But you're right. The cost of taking my house and my property to the government, the cost benefit does not work in the government's favor at the moment. Because
right.
Even if they did take it, now they're holding on to a piece of property. What are they going to do with it? They're going to have to sell it. They're going to have to sucker some other putts to come in and start cleaning it up and getting it nice and mowing the lawn and taking care of it and starting to pay the property tax and so on and so forth. It's better to control than it is to own.
Right. That is key. It's better to control than it is. And in the end, the controller is the owner. It's just they're the owner without liabilities. That's what a
Correct.
Controller is. They're the owner without liabilities. It's kind of like the old surf system where the surf had a plot of land which the Lord owned, and the surf got to work the land and got to keep a certain amount of what he made or grew on the land for himself, and a certain percentage had to go to the Lord. And in addition to that, the surf also had to pay the Lord a fee for using the land. And in addition to that, the surf had a certain amount of work that the surf had to do for the Lord on the Lord's land. Well, that's kind of the deal that you have right now with property taxes. And whether you like property taxes, whether you think there's a good reason to have property taxes or not, the reality of power is that you are in a distinct disadvantage in this current system. If as a quote-unquote homeowner, you're in a distinct disadvantage against an external force. So let me ask you this, Dimitri, and to some degree, I think both of us are working on trying towards some sort of, I don't know if necessarily is there a solution so much as there is a mitigation. What would you recommend to people to move towards, to tilt, even if you can't tilt it totally in your favor, to at least raise the cost of coercion for the controller, if you will?
Well, for me, first and foremost, is to become less dependent on the master and to disconnect from the system as much as possible. The more disconnected you are, the less you are in the institution's shadow. It's kind of like, hey, you're eating for free? Well, then you owe me. And you don't want to owe the government.
No, you don't want to owe the government. Really, and you don't want to owe the corporations that are...
Or the
very much
either.
Well, the banks, the corporations that are walking, they're almost one and the same at this point.
Well, I would argue, and I think other men far more knowledgeable than myself have argued, that at this point it is the banks that are running the country, and that's not a conspiracy. It's out in the open.
1913 settled that.
Yeah, exactly. And we've had 100 years of, you know, pretty much it being out in the open that the people with the money ran the elections, and the people who run the elections control the narratives, and that's all there is to it.
Yeah, it's just a matter of facing the reality of power. So this is some of the things as we do these shows. We're going to be sometimes we're going to be talking about like real practical things that you can do to increase your space to be able to make your own decisions, to say yes or no of your own free will. And sometimes we'll, I know Dimitri will love this part. He loves talking theory. So, but we will talk some theory. We'll talk some political theory. We'll
I'm getting ready to talk some theory to my pillow.
You're not going to do that. So, because we still have a second half of the show up ahead, which we're about ready to go to. And on the second half of this show, we are
going... Do you have any no-dos?
I don't... I do. I cannot transport them to you, even if I did, so...
Drone?
Oh, you want me to drone them over to you?
You should.
Oh, I'll drone you. I'll drone you. Yeah. So, on the other side of... After this quick break, we're going to be talking to Michael Cessna, who is the chief military correspondent for Military Gazette. And we're going to bring him on... To
Michael's an interesting character.
Yeah, the
very insightful man.
Yeah, the folks that maybe feel a little complacent, maybe feel a little bit safe. Maybe Michael will help you dispense with that myth. If you think just because your guy won that you're safe and that you can go ahead and just embrace the world around you and feel wonderful and safe. Maybe not so much.
That can change in an instant.
In an instant. And we'll talk more about that. Also, we'll talk to you on the other side, and we'll be joined by Michael Cessna.
Tired of those guns that don't shoot themselves? Do you wish you, too, had one of those guns that shoots 30 clips a second? How about a gun with a bullet button that will convert your single-shot bolt-action rifle to an automatic assault weapon? Well, have we got the gun for you? You've heard all those politicians talking about this gun, but you didn't think it was real, right? Well, it's real. It's called the Super Duper Crap It's Real Gun. That's right, the Super Duper Crap It's Real Gun. And now, you can buy this gun for only $5 by just calling this number, 1-800-GET-A-GUN. That's 1-800-GET-A-GUN. Just give us an address and pay COD when we deliver it. The Super Duper Crap It's Real Gun. Finally, an automatic assault weapon that will mow down your neighbors all by itself.
Brought to you by the makers of Invisible Passports, the indestructible passport for the savvy terrorist that wants to make sure people remember him after he's gone. This gun may not be available in any of the 50 states or in any of the countries that exist on the planet today. If you do actually call 1-800-GET-A-GUN, you might not actually get through to an operator that's actually selling the Super Duper Crap It's Real Gun. This is a parody commercial intended to trigger the jimmies of your gun-phobic state-worshipping friends.
And ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to VisPrivus. That is, what is this? Who sponsors the show? Come on. Who's the sponsor of the show, Dimitri? I mean, this is only the second half of the first show, but you should have this down by now. Who sponsors the show?
The Hungarian guy from Hungary.
No, this is iState.tv, but you can find all our stuff at istv.com. istv.me. You'll find it all there.
And we're not the Coal Brothers.
No, I have no idea what you're saying. This show's off to a horrible start. We should probably stop it before it goes.
Start. We're picking up where we left off.
So on this half of the show, we have with us a special guest. That's right. We have Michael Cessna of Military Gazette. And Michael, okay. I have a written script here for, ready? All right, ladies and gentlemen, drum roll, please. Ladies and gentlemen, we now feature Michael Cessna, the chief military affairs correspondent for the Military Gazette. Welcome to VisPrivus, Michael. Say hi to the VisPrivus audience.
Hello, VisPrivus.
It's
a pleasure to be here.
Isn't it? I mean, it is. I feel like we just talked to you recently.
It was not that long ago.
I'm thinking it was maybe just a few days ago. I think maybe Tuesday we talked to you. And today's Thursday. So we talked to you on full auto. We were talking about some military surplus guns. And we brought Michael on to VisPrivus because, Michael, could you describe what you do for Military Gazette?
Well, I'm the chief military affairs correspondent, so I am the I'm the chief writer for the magazine. So I'm the guy who gets to go out and find out about all of the weird little wars that you've never heard of. that have usually been going on for about 60 or 70 years.
And you have special tools that you can track stuff with, right?
I do. I have news aggregator websites that specialize in security and defense and terrorism related news. And as well, I've got other resources out there that I can reach out to when I need to dig into something in a little more depth.
So, Dimitri, this is the guy to have on the show with you, wouldn't you say? Because,
oh, yeah.
Because Dimitri loves talking world news, and the more obscure, the better. And let me ask you, of all the things that are going on right now, Michael, what mm-hmm. is the strangest conflict? I don't want to say with the biggest ramification. Maybe it does, maybe it mm-hmm. doesn't. I'll let you be the judge of what you consider. What's the strangest conflict that's going on right now that no one has even knows is going on?
Oh, that's an even toss-up between the Siege of Imphal and the Cabinda Liberation Front.
Oh, we got to go with Cabinda Liberation Front first.
What now?
I know something about the one, but not the other.
Well, as Cabinda, if you look on a map of Africa and you find Angola, immediately to the north of Angola, you have Zaire or the Democratic Republic of the Congo or whatever they're calling it this week. Because, you know, hey, that's what happens when you get rid of Mobutu. But there's what's called an exclave. It's kind of a state of Angola that is not physically connected to Angola, and that is Cabinda. And there's this little tale from the Democratic Republic of the Congo that kind of cuts along the Congo River that separates the two. And Cabinda, since it was a Portuguese colony, has always had its own little bitty independence movement. And nobody really knows about them because their numbers are really small. They don't have a lot in the way of weapons. They try hard, but there's just not a whole lot of Angolan government forces to shoot at. And they don't really have a big impact on the world stage, because although Cabinda is where Angola gets all of its oil revenues, every 100% of the oil infrastructure is offshore. And the freedom and liberation movement for Cabinda, it kind of translates over from Portuguese, so it's not an exact one, but the acronym comes out as FLEC.
FLAC or FLEC?
FLEC. FLEC.
Oh, FLEC is way more fun, so I'm glad it's FLEC.
I'm not even kidding. FLEC.
I'm a big FLEC fan.
There you go. They just don't have the boating assets to actually get out and do anything to the oil booms, the oil derricks that are offshore. That's kind of a non-starter. So they shoot up the occasional police post and make pronouncements, and eventually a reporter will listen to them, take pity on them, and put out a little press release for them. But that's been going on now for about 40 years in fits and starts.
I've never heard of it.
And hasn't the government gone in and just wiped them out if it's such a small movement?
Because it's not really worth it. And they've had bigger, and the government's had bigger fish to fry. Basically, the big war in Angola was always UNITA, mostly in the south, which occasionally had, before apartheid fell apart, UNITA had South African support. So that was the big focus for Angola. The FLEC just was never a credible threat. And it just wasn't worth really driving through and you know, giving it a lot more credence than it really deserves. I feel bad for the FLEC. You know, they're kind of like Wile E. Coyote.
It's kind of what was going through my mind when you're talking about it.
Like these. I mean, they really are. You kind of gotta try and root for them, but they're just the ones you look at and you go, damn. I'll give you props for trying there, guy. But wow.
Go ahead.
For me, I keep thinking of Mel Brooks or Woody Allen doing a Revolutionary War. That's what keeps coming to my mind.
That is about the level that we're talking about here.
So Woody Allen did a Revolutionary War so that the Americans would send them money.
Yeah,
that was his thing. If you do some stuff, then the Americans will hush you up and send you money. That's the whole shtick there that he was doing.
Right, except that in this case, Union Oil doesn't want to spend the money on mercenaries to go solve the problem. Mostly because why?
You're going to kill a bunch of guys who, you know, you're going to kill a bunch of guys who can barely shoot. Essentially,
that's when their AKs are actually shooting. that presumes that they have ammunition to shoot.
So they're like the Keystone Cops of revolutionaries. Is that what you're saying?
They're not at the level of Operation Red Dog, but
Operation Red Dog?
Operation Red Dog is something that came out.
No idea.
Go ahead.
I am lost here.
Yeah, Operation Red Dog. Operation Red Dog dates from when I was in high school. Dates from 1981. That was a Keystone Cops coup d'état that was fixing to happen, and it's kind of an interesting story. There is a book now called The Bayou of Pigs that details it in exhaustive detail, done by a Canadian reporter. And what it was, this guy had been masquerading as a Marine Vietnam veteran, and he had kind of by force of will, he tried to put together a mercenary-led coup d'etat against the island of Dominica. Not the Dominican Republic, Dominica. Which is this little banana republic way out in like the Leeward Isles of the Caribbean that, you know, it's teeny tiny. Nobody's ever heard of it. But this guy was going to try and go in there and seize the island. And the collection of people that he assembled to do this was, wow. White supremacists, neo-Nazis, the occasional guy who'd been unemployed but had been in the National Guard at one point. I mean, it was like a really bad 80s movie before there were bad 80s movies.
Maybe this is where they learned it.
I honestly believe that probably happened. That probably did spawn several movies like that, because this guy put together he assembled a whole bunch of weapons. He assembled a Bushmaster assault rifles, the early model Bushmasters before they started doing ARs. That was their unique proprietary thing. He assembled, I think, like 40 Bushmaster rifles and had a bunch of other military type stuff to go with them.
Are you using the word type loosely?
Yeah.
Was he using the Miami Vice theme song as his own?
I think he wanted to be his name. The guy's name, the organizer's name was Purdue, and I think
just Purdue.
That was his last name.
Okay, because it'd be great if his name was just Purdue.
That would be cool.
Awesome.
He had a problem though. He had a reasonable sized team for what he was going to try and do, but his big problem was he had guns, he had ammunition, he even had some homemade grenades. He just didn't have a way to get to Dominica.
He needed the boat from Miami Vice.
That's a tiny problem.
So he goes down into Florida, and he finds this guy. The guy's name is Captain Mike. He's dead. He's recently passed away. Captain Mike was well known around South Florida. He was kind of a, you know, he'd been a Navy SEAL, or he'd gotten a Bronze Star in Vietnam. You know, he was a legit war hero guy, and he had a fishing boat, like a tourist fishing boat, but it was one of those long range Caribbean boats that could make Jamaica. You know, so he could get to Dominica pretty easily. So Perdue goes down and finds this guy, and he's talking to him, and he's trying to convince him that he's a CIA agent. And, you know, Captain Mike was like, okay, look, man, I know you're not going down here to do fishing or oceanographic research, whatever it is you're trying to tell me. What are you really trying to do? And the guy thought about it for a minute, and he said, I'm going to take 40 Bushmaster assault rifles and a dozen guys and take over the island. And he's like, whoa, okay. Yeah, I didn't know what was going to happen there. But that's when Perdue tries to say, yeah, you know, I'm CIA and we're going to go down and take over this island. And Captain Mike talked his way into getting the guy off the boat. And then he calls up the State Department and says, are we trying to take over Dominica? And the State Department's like, no, and neither's the CIA. So please help us catch these guys before they do any real damage. And they ended up setting up a sting operation with the ATF and the FBI, and they bagged the entire mercenary group before they could get on the boat. And it was a comedy of errors. 1981 was not a good year for mercenary operations.
What on earth was his motivation of taking over the
island?
Yeah,
I was going to ask that.
What the hell was this guy thinking?
Basically, they wanted to have, when you take over, and this is very serious, when you take over a country, or when you get to be in charge of a country, you have a seat in the United Nations. You have a seat at the World Bank. You can get end user certificates, and that's important because in the international world, if you want to go out and buy weaponry, and I don't mean going down and picking up, you know, the handgun and maybe a rifle at the corner store. I mean, when you want to go out and buy 5,000, you know, M16s or 5,000 AK-47s and do it legitimately, you need an end user certificate.
You want to put quotation marks around that word legitimately.
Well, yeah, legitimately. But this is how the arms trade, the legitimate arms trade is done, is, you know, you have a letter from an actual government that somebody can pick up the phone, call that government and say, do you know who this person is? And they say, yes, we do. They're there at our behest. And they're our purchasing agent. And they're like, oh, okay. Well, you know, thank you, Mr. Gordon. We'll go ahead and process your order for, you know, 10,000 AK-47s and, 15 D-30 howitzers and, you know, these 30 main battle tanks. We'll get right on that. You know, do you have a ship? And you go from there. That's the kind of thing an end user certificate gets you. And their goal was not only to plug into that, but to use the island as a base for drug smugglers. Because then you can bring in cocaine to the United States in diplomatic bags.
So if this they had the sophisticated plan. So why would this guy tell Captain Mike what he told him?
These guys had a reporter from a newspaper in Canada who they explained the entire plan to.
Wow.
Before they even came to the United States.
Thank God for dumb thugs.
I tell you what, and one of those dumb thugs, you are going to love this. I'm probably going to have to pull my headset away from the laughter that is about to ensue.
I will not laugh.
One of the dumb thugs involved in this is still out there and still in the public eye. His name is Don Black, and he runs the white supremacist site Stormfront.
Oh, no way.
I'm dead serious.
Oh, snap.
Dead.
Wow.
I don't find that funny. I find
it scary. Scary.
Disturbing.
I find it, well, it's
funny in a dark way.
It is. I do have a gallows.
It is funny in a dark way. It's
you can't do what I do and not have a gallows humor. But I look at these guys. If these guys were capable of anything real, it would have happened a long time ago. Operation Red Dog actually had what for the mercenary world constitutes real funding. For 1981, they had quite a bit of money to back them up. The plan wasn't bad. It's just
the gabbing.
Couldn't have done it. These guys were idiots. I mean, they were idiots from start to finish. They were literally going to load their magazines, get on the boat, and go. There was no training cycle. There was no teamwork building, you know, nothing like that. No class where we're going to sit down and, okay, everybody, we're in a warehouse, but we're going to walk through. Here's what we're going to do for, you know, fire team drills and squad drills and buddy drills. We're not going to do anything like that.
So they were all like Leroy Jenkins.
Leroy
Jenkins. He just bashed in. No plans.
Yeah,
no.
Pretty much. Yeah. We're going to get off the boat. We're going to like throw sticks of dynamite into the police station and basically shoot anybody who ain't us.
So let me switch gears a little bit here.
Sure.
One of the reasons that I actually wanted you to talk about this, because I wanted to kind of make it visible to folks.
Right.
I mean, we just scratched the surface of the stuff that's going on. We didn't even get to your second one, and that's fine. We'll get to it. There's so much more going on in this world that you can't even imagine. And we get locked in these paradigms where we're in, you know, the American paradigm, the Russian, whatever your paradigms are. And there's a whole host of activity that's going on below the surface that could potentially somewhere down the road affect how you should be planning and why you should be planning. And let me ask you this. Of all the things that you're looking at right now, if you can name it down to one or two, what are the things out there that nobody's heard of that could actually affect their, if things go a certain way, that could actually affect their lives in a very profound way? And even after they're affected, they probably still won't know.
Well, they would know when this happened. They don't know. Nobody knows about it right now because Military Gazette is the only, as far as I've been able to tell, Military Gazette is the only Western news organ that's actually reporting on this, is the siege of Imphal that's going on right now.
And that's your second thing that you brought up.
That was
in the
very second
beginning.
Thing. And that's extremely dangerous. That's Operation Red Dog. That's something you can drink over and have a good laugh. There's nothing funny about Imphal.
Why don't you tell our studio audience about that?
The city of Imphal is in the northeastern part of India, and it is a state capital, you know, like Austin or, you know, the closest analog that I can find to Imphal in the United States would be Boise, Idaho. The cities are about the same size and population, and they both sit at the bottom of a bowl valley surrounded by mountains. The only real difference is Idaho or Boise is buried under snow. Imphal sits in the middle of a jungle. Okay. The problem is Imphal has been under siege since November 1st by the National Socialist Council of Nagaland.
Have you ever heard of this, Dimitri?
No.
When India gained its independence from Britain and was no longer a colony, the far northeastern part of India, when you look at a map of India, at the top of the Bay of Bengal, you've got Bangladesh, and India kind of wraps around Bangladesh. Manipur, which is the state Imphal is the capital of, kind of sits in that area. and it butts right up against the border with Burma or Myanmar, however you want to, whatever you want to call that. But that section of India really got the short end of the stick when India was organized. It's still very remote. Literacy is not good in the area. Economic development is, frankly, terrible all through the states in that region. It's very much, not very much has changed in that region since World War II. And the people there really don't like it. There's not a lot of government investment, and it's just, it's economically depressed. The problem, one of the main problems is you've got tribal groups in the area, and the main group is called the Naga, and N-A-G-A. And the Naga are, they're rather uniquely, they are sort of socialist, but they're devoutly Christian.
Okay.
And they are, they've had a long running insurgency in the area, along with multiple rebel groups. But what's happened recently is the state government in Imphal, and I just can't understand, this is the part I still don't understand why they're doing this. They tried this gerrymandering scheme to break up, you know, to rearrange the districts in the state of Manipur. And what they were trying to do was undercut Naga numbers, because if the Naga are not the majority population in Manipur, they're really close to being the majority. And as soon as they came up with this weird redistricting program, the Naga said, you know what? No, we're not going to do this. We're not going to put up with this. And they declared an economic blockade on November 1st of 2016. And I didn't actually find out about this because it wasn't really, there wasn't really a level of violence or impact on the city at that point until about mid-December. And I was just really perplexed. I had no idea what was going on. And it took a while to actually tweezer it apart. But what they've done, when you look at a map of Imphal, there's only two ways into the city. There's only two highways going in. They've completely cut one highway. And they run a blockade on the other highway. And no convoys can get through. Imagine cutting off the semi-truck traffic to a major American city.
Even if it was Boise. Yeah.
That's going to cause a problem, and it's already causing a problem. Some convoys are able to get through, but when I read the descriptions of this, and if you've never really read through Indian newspapers, it's a very different dynamic in how they deliver information. So that takes a little bit, but when you read through it, the Indian gendarmes, which are the Assam Rifles, which is kind of a core sized element, you know, about 60,000 people, they're building convoys on the far side of the mountains, and they're driving it down Highway 37. And
the, oh yes, Highway 37, right.
Yeah, the Naga guerrillas will basically steal a bunch of cars, pull them into the road, and torch them as the convoy approaches. And when these
Christians, right?
They, when they unload, the security forces unload from the convoy. That's when they, you know, start firing random shots at them, because then it slows the convoy down even more. Because now they got to sweep the side of the road. So now we're at the point where the Indian Air Force is flying in tanker trucks of fuel to keep essential government services running.
I need to back this conversation up a little bit.
Sorry.
No, sorry. I want to explore something a little bit. Mm-hmm. When you say they're Christians, mm-hmm. what does that mean?
They're Baptists. They were converted by English missionaries back in the 19th century.
Militant okay. Baptists. Okay.
They are very militant Baptists. And there's another part to this that which is how it affects the United States. This has been going on now. This whole siege has been going on, obviously, since November. What had happened, and I noticed this, and I blurred this came up as a news item, and I wrote about it in December for Military Gazette, and it was so strange that it jumped out at me that these groups, these insurgent groups, were hiring nurses. They were hiring medical nurses. And, offering good pay, benefits. I mean, just like you were going to work at a hospital, but, you know, we're going to transport you into the jungle, into a guerrilla camp. And you're going to be you're going to join the medical staff out here. Anytime you hear about a guerrilla army, any guerrilla army, that's trying to recruit medical personnel, that means they're gearing up for an offensive. And and that's when they're doing it seriously, because medical talent is one of the hardest things to come by with guerrilla armies. So they're always on the lookout for medical personnel. That's why you hear about people being, people from like Doctors Without Borders being kidnapped, UN doctors being kidnapped when they go to these conflict zones, because the people doing the kidnapping want to put them to work. Because they need medical help and they don't have it. So I see this, and it's like, wow, there's going to be, there's usually a lead time of about 3 months when this kind of thing starts happening. So I'm looking out towards February, March, that time frame. And this is in December. And then January 3rd, it comes out that this coalition of insurgent groups, basically directed by the National Socialist Council of Nagaland and another allied group over in Assam, issued a statement advising that the Indian central government was engaging in colonialism and trying to resettle people in traditional tribal areas, not just Naga, but other tribes, and that all Hindi and Bengali speakers had until March 31st to vacate these certain areas of like three different states.
Christian Baptists.
No, those are the guys issuing this directive.
That's what I'm saying. Wait, those are the Christian Baptists that are issuing this.
Right.
Right.
And the reason this is important is, number one, Hindi speakers are generally Hindus. Religiously, which, that kind of goes without saying, we're talking about India, but Bengali speakers are almost uniformly Muslim.
Wow.
Now, the problem with this is if the NSCN carries through on this threat, and it's the NSCN and ULFA, those are the parent groups, if they carry through on this, and after March 31st, they start, for all intents and purposes, ethnic cleansing of the area, sectarian cleansing, pushing out Hindus, pushing out Muslims. The Muslim world is going to go bananas if that starts happening, because it's not the Indian government doing this. It's going to be specifically Christians doing it.
Wow.
And
a Christian holy war against Muslims.
And that's going to put pressure.
Yeah, but it's not a holy war. It's a demographics war. They're under pressure, and they're being redistricted by the Indian government to keep them under control. They don't see it as a holy war. They see it as a cultural identity war.
Exactly. From
it's not
their
a Christian
side.
Issue here. Yeah.
From their side.
Right, but that's not how it's going to play out.
That's not how it'll play in the Muslim world.
Right.
The Muslim world will see this as a directed Christian offensive against Muslims.
Well, the Muslim world sees everyone as attacking them when they're in fact attacking everyone. I mean, if you're going to get into this subject in that part of the world, you got to look at the Uyghurs as well, and you got to look at all of these different groups that Go ahead.
Here's the thing. This is why this is important. It puts pressure, if that happens, it puts pressure on the government of Pakistan to act and do something. Because within the Muslim world, Bangladesh doesn't rate very high on the scale. Pakistan, on the other hand, does rate very high. The government in Islamabad is going to be expected to do something. And by do something, the Muslim world will expect them to go to war to protect fellow Muslims. And Pakistan obviously is not going to want to do that. They've got a basket load of problems that they don't need to go to war with India right now. But they might see it as the only way to quiet their restive elements. And if they still don't do that, they can always go the way of Iran. And the danger here is that you now have, we've had Indo-Pakistani wars, India and Pakistan wars before. Now both sides have nuclear weapons.
Yeah, and Pakistan has never fared well in those wars.
Pakistan has always lost.
Yeah, Pakistan has always been on the receiving end. Yeah, of an ass.
They always start it. They always attack, and India always stomps them into a thin spot of moisture. but having nuclear weapons tends to make people think weird thoughts, and there is a very scary chance that we might actually see a nuke get used, or two, or three, that might actually get used if something like this comes to pass. And this is one of those bizarre triggers that does float around out there that you'd never expect that World War III could start over this. And I'm not going to say that World War III is a danger here, but people think, when you say nuclear weapon, people immediately think World War III. And the real danger is that the politics in the area are so muddied that India and the U.S. don't have – we've always had a very difficult relationship.
Love-hate.
Primarily because every time something starts between them and Pakistan, we usually end up backing Pakistan.
Right.
Why on earth
– it makes no sense.
Has that been the case?
I have no idea. I do.
Because the British partitioned Pakistan off from India to keep India destabilized. And you cannot, as a Western power, you cannot allow India to raise its head up, because India would be a serious world power. Mm-hmm. It's got the manpower. It's got resources. It's got raw materials.
Got an advanced culture.
Yeah. Oh, mm-hmm. Tremendously. If it actually started to create a real viable economy, it would be on the international scene like any European power has been in the past.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we side with Pakistan. But lately, Pakistan has been drawing very closely with the Russians. They've been signing military agreements, which is to the consternation of India, because India has always bought most of its equipment
from the
Soviet Union and now Russia.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very interesting. I think the Russians will have political sway with Pakistan and telling them, hey, knock it off.
I think the Russians are playing a strange game where they seem to be reaching out to everybody. Mm-hmm. And many, like, who are... I mean, they're reaching out to Israel while they're reaching out to Iran, and they're making inroads into both of those areas, significant inroads. So, you could theoretically see a Russian peace that could emerge.
Sure, the Pax Russiana.
Yeah, because if Russia would be like, hey, boys, y'all need to get along because I need to make money.
Well, the other factor to look at with Pakistan is China. In Indo-Pak relations, you have to look at China, because China now has a naval station. They have taken over part of the docking areas in Gwadar, on the Indian Ocean coast of Pakistan. That's where they're reprovisioning their ships that are on the anti-piracy patrol off the Horn of Africa, so they don't have to go all the way back to China.
Yeah, but the Chinese just built just connected railways with India and Iran.
Yeah, they're building railways everywhere. They're making connections. Yeah. They're trying to build railways right to Europe.
The Chinese are playing the same game. They're they're not taking sides.
Right, they're trying to be friends with everybody.
Yeah,
and that's also worrisome to India because that encourages Pakistan. And that's not good for India. At the same time, the Indian economy is in flux right now because of the whole cash situation. Where Modi basically called in all of the old all of the banknotes that were less than 100 rupees in denomination, and did it pretty much overnight. And this was back in October, and it's just since then you've seen there's been a huge upswing in communist guerrillas, communist guerrilla action throughout the Red Corridor. The Red Corridor is in eastern India that kind of runs almost the spine of the country in the east, where there's this huge concentration of Maoist rebel groups. And there's been a huge uptick in activity since then, and it's been strictly because of this whole cash situation, because people had relied on the sub 100 rupee notes for day-to-day use, and now suddenly all of that's been withdrawn, and they have to come in and exchange it with the government.
How much support do these Maoists get from China and Indonesia and other points west, east? Zero.
Yep. Zero. China never really backed those guys, primarily because they didn't want to poke the Russians, because at the time the whole Naxalite revolution or the whole Naxalite uprising began. The Naxalites are – Naxalite is the term for Indian Maoists locally. At the time the Naxalite insurgency began, India was very good friends with Russia, and China didn't really want to stir that pot. So they just kind of left them – they kind of left the Maoists in India on the vine and just, moral support, yay, rock on. And didn't do anything else. They were more concerned with making inroads into Africa. And as the Soviet Union imploded, the concentration for China, as it was digging itself out after Tiananmen Square, their focus, they ended up focusing more on Sri Lanka rather than India, because India was still kind of a Russian bailiwick, and China still didn't want to tread there, but Sri Lanka, that was a whole different story. And that's exactly how the Tamil insurgency ended, was China pretty much just said, hey, we'll cover you. They told Trincomalee, the capital in Sri Lanka, they said, we'll cover you. We'll cover your back on the world stage. Here's a whole mess of gear. Here's a whole mess of weapons. Whatever you need to do to end the Tamil rebellion, end it. We don't care how you do it. And they took him at their word. And when the Red Cross pulls out and says, we can't deal with the Sinhalese government in Trincomalee because they're using our data that we're providing them under established international agreements. They're using our data for artillery targeting, specifically to target hospitals.
Oof.
Dang. That's
by any means necessary.
That's how the whole Tamil rebellion in Sri Lanka ended. I mean, it was a massacre by any stretch of the imagination. It was horrifying. There's video out there that the BBC did, and it's it's extremely disturbing. You hear that a lot in programming now, you know, warning, you know, graphic content. No, this is disturbing. This is like American troops overrunning concentration camps in Germany. Disturbing. Literally shoveling bodies into trucks and dumping them in a ditch. Because we're going to do a rolling artillery barrage through the hospital area. Because we want to make sure, you know. And I don't mean that flippantly. It's really disturbing enough. I'm going to pull up my, because I actually saved this, because I don't recall the, where is it? Where's my videos? Darn it. I don't recall the name of it, off the top of my head. I'll find it. I'll have to send it. Oh, there it is. Hang on.
Okay. So we're just about at the end of the show. So let's get this wrapped up. No, it's okay. No, this is incredible stuff. It's good stuff.
The core of this is that I don't see India backing down, in the Northeast, and that's a bad thing. It's a very very volatile situation.
What is the population of these Baptists?
That I'm going to have to look at, but it's actually the only good side of this is that it's one of the more remote regions, so it's not as populated.
So, I mean, Boise, is that a town of like 100,000, something like that? What would Boise be?
Boise itself is about 650,000.
Oh, bigger than I thought. Way bigger than I thought.
Imphal is about 450,000. The population of the state of Nagaland itself is maybe 2.25 million.
Significant enough.
And about the same in Manipur, which is the capital of, where Imphal is the capital of. So we're looking at maybe 8 million people impacted immediately. And I would say that as far as the Baptist population goes, that's going to be probably 6 million of that, 6 million out of 8.
Wow. Yeah. So significant. So what I'm hoping that our listeners here, there's a lot of folks, we hope to be a show where folks from, I'm going to say, from a lot of different political perspectives will find something of interest for them. Even some very, you know, old school Democrats, I'm going to say, can find stuff to like about this show. But I'm going to target this for the conservatives who are probably feeling a little bit in their cups right now because their boy won and they're in power. You're just hearing a taste of what's going on in the world. And all the potential little tinderboxes that could go off, unexpected things that could suddenly change the dynamic. Don't stop preparing. Don't stop looking at your life and asking yourself, how can I reduce my entanglement with outside forces that could someday very, very, very well turn against me? Just because your boy is in power doesn't mean that something couldn't happen a day from now, a week from now, that could totally change the dynamic. And suddenly, because you're not moving towards that place, you're going to be caught flat-footed. Dimitri, any closing thoughts here?
Well, there's always stuff going on, and it doesn't take much scratching under the surface to see it. There's stuff going on in Eastern Europe right now. There's stuff going on in North Africa. There's stuff going on still in the Philippines, all over China, throughout Southeast Asia, as you've heard. There's stuff, And, you know, the United States is not unique in the world. We are human like like the rest of the world. Something could kick off at any moment. And you would be surprised in the history of mankind where stuff originates and where conflicts and disturbances sprout from. From a natural disaster to stupid people trying to take over an island. It's by the grace of God that we live in a very stable environment. But it wouldn't take much to get people to do stupid things. So to add to what Paul is saying, I'm not saying to prepare like preppers. And
yeah, I'm not either.
Jars of hundreds of jars in your basement of, you know, peaches because you think that's what's going to get you through a calamity. But learn to be independent. Learn to do things on your own. Learn to create things for yourself. Create the networks of people that you can rely on. That is a very responsible and reasonable way to live.
Michael, do you have any closing remarks here in that vein? Especially because, I mean, you are... Dimitri and I, we look at the world affairs, certainly, but not to the degree that you are. You're looking at a microscope with everything. So...
Excuse me, I'm sorry. Closing thoughts on that would be pay attention to what's going on in the world. Pay attention to what's going on further than 50 miles from the nearest shopping mall.
Yeah.
Okay, because 100 years ago, as we're talking today, no one believed that a major European war would be started by the actions of an 18-year-old punk with tuberculosis.
Right.
Okay,
Gavril Princeps,
That came out of nowhere. No one ever saw that coming. All of a sudden, everybody woke up one day and literally woke up and found themselves in the middle of a war.
Not to scare people, but what, God forbid, what would happen if Donald Trump was killed tomorrow? I think
it'd be civil war in America the next day.
That we would get very close to that. If we didn't reach a point of civil war, we would be getting as close as we've been in, 200 years, 100 years.
We're as close right now as we've ever been.
Yeah, and the left is itching for a fight. They want it.
Well, and the left is stupid to do that. They really are.
Right, they're not in the best position.
Yeah, it is stupid for them to do it. They'll be like Pakistan in that exchange, but it's still going to hurt you. It's still going to mess up your daily routine. So I'm gonna wrap things up. We're definitely gonna have to have you on again to talk about some world stuff here.
Not a problem.
But I certainly learned some stuff there, and Dimitri, I'm sure that you've learned some stuff there as well, and
I got to do some reading.
Yeah, and both of us Baptist. I mean, both of us, we pay attention to the world, and of us are like, whoa.
It kind of surprised me because I know there are ancient groups of Christians in India that predate the British and the Baptists, and I wonder how they fall into this. There were the Asian apostles that don't get much coverage here in the West.
There were apostles who went into India, and
correct.
Then they had their
So it's a curious thing to me to hear that Pakistan and India might get into it over a group of Christians.
I said,
the world is stranger than you can. So I want to thank
that's right.
I want to thank Michael Cessna, and be sure you go to militarygazette.com and you can read Michael's stuff. You do a daily sit rep, I think most every day, just about, right?
Well, it's actually weekly now.
Weekly sit rep. That makes sense because it would be. So he does a weekly sit rep. He does stuff throughout the week as well. And my brother Bill William Collier also does work on that as well. And every once in a while I do stuff on there, but as, I haven't done it in a while, but I have. I'll come back again. I will. So thank you very much, Michael. And this, you have been on the debut version of VisPrivus. So I really appreciate having you on here. And
glad to be here.
And it was nice meeting you, Michael.
And nice to meet you too, Dimitri.
And next week we will talk. Well, we're going to talk. We'll explore more a little bit about your reality of power. And we'll talk about what are you doing, what can be done for you to move towards a position where you have more power to say yes and say no, and how you should face your responsibility in moving in that direction. So we'll see you next week, Thursday at 8 p.m. on iState TV. That's the Facebook page, but you can find everything at istv.me. See you next week.
Adios.
Good night.